Good evening and welcome to RCTV's live coverage of the April 4th, 2017 Reading Mass election. I'm Katie Robertson and I'm here tonight with Ryan Panett. Welcome, Ryan.
Happy to be here.
Yeah, this is an exciting night. We have several contested races and a ballot question that have been on a lot of people's minds over the past few weeks and months.
Yep, a lot of open seats or seats that are up for grabs tonight, both for the selectmen and for the school committee. So we'll see how things shake down as the evening progresses. You know, there's been a lot of campaigning all over town and sign holding, and we are waiting to see as we look here at the Walter Hawks Fieldhouse. We have a crew down there tonight, and we're going to be able to correspond with them and see how it's going from down there. But lots of excitement tonight.
Yes, the polls are open for another half an hour or so until 8 o'clock. They open this morning at 7 a.m. So it sounds like there's been about an average amount of turnout. I believe the latest numbers were 15.9%. As of 7 o'clock, which is maybe a little ahead of average, so that's a good sign.
Always a good sign when you get voter turnout.
Yeah, and especially because of the rain. It's pretty gross out there today, so it's good to be able to see people still coming out.
Definitely.
So we are going to go to John Carpenter, who's down at the Fieldhouse with us. Thanks, John. So that was John. Hopefully we'll be checking in with him again throughout the rest of the evening.
We'll get the whole crew down there bringing you the best and the latest from the Walter Hawks Fieldhouse tonight as we near the close of the election.
Yes. So we do have some maps to show, though, about how the town shakes down based on precincts. There are 8 precincts in town, as many people know, and those are rezoned every 10 years based on the census. There are 8 town meeting members for each precinct, which I think comes out to 192 town meeting members total. Many of those are on the ballot for today. So I think that we are going to be able to look at a map. Yes, here's Reading based precinct by precinct. So that breaks it down a little bit. If we can go closer on Precinct 1, that's up by the Wood End Cemetery. It includes Killam and Burbank as well on that Linfield North Reading line. Precinct 2?
Precinct 2 here encompasses the fire station, the police station, also Memorial Park, as we see here, that borders down on Wakefield. Also, Hunt Memorial Park in there as well make up Precinct 2.
Precinct 3 here down at Stoneham is the bottom part of 28, the southern part of 28, and then over there on Wakefield all the way up to RMLD and up that way.
Precinct 4 is on the Woburn side of town, which encompasses the Joshua Eaton School. So you're looking down there as West Street runs down through the town of Reading. That is Precinct 4.
Precinct 5 here in the middle has the depot, so right by Washington Park and Parker Middle School. And then on the northern section, it's got the public library as well.
And Precinct 6 is on the left side of town, the northwest side of town, bordering with Wilmington and Woburn, which has the Barrow School, and also Austin Prep falls within that as well.
Precinct 7, also back to the center, has RMHS, Birch Meadow, Coolidge, obviously the Field House, which is where our team is today, and then right back south towards the Laurel Hill Cemetery near the fire station.
And our 8th precinct in the town of Reading borders with North Reading, encompassing the Wood End School, and all points north and west in the town of Reading.
So that gives an overview on where we all live and where we're voting today. We do have the most important parts of the ballot today, in addition to the town meeting, are the contested and the 2 uncontested races that are on the ballot today. So if we can just get an overview of what people were looking at today when they were voting. We do have the Board of Selectmen race, the 2 school committee races, And then the two uncontested races, which are the moderator and the RMLD board, the library board is also a contested race, and then the ballot question.
Correct. So lots of things for the citizens of Reading to be voting on today to move this community forward.
Yes. You and I both worked on the forums here for RCTV. You and I spoke with the Board of Selectmen, myself and John Carpenter spoke with the school committee members. So I think that those forums were very well received, and I enjoyed doing them. I hadn't done them before, actually.
Yeah, a great opportunity for the candidates in our local elections to put their name out there and put their ideas and their vision out there for the town of Reading. So a good opportunity for them to be able to share their story ahead of voting.
Yeah. And I think those got a lot of views on YouTube and through our election page. So here we are in ballot order. Alan Folds is up for 1 year for moderator, I believe the 21st year consecutive.
Our Board of Selectmen, this is a three-year seat, and the candidates in that are John Halsey, Kevin Sexton, and Andrew Friedman.
For the Board of Library Trustees, also for 3 years, we have Ruth Doucette, Nina Pinacchio, and Sherry Vandenacker.
And for the Municipal Light Board, which is a three-year position, Thomas O'Rourke is the candidate in that spot.
The school committee for 3 year seat, which is, there will be two winners in this candidacy, Jean Borowski, Linda Snow-Doxer, and Aaron Calvobacci.
And on the school committee for the 2 year seat, we have Carl Anderson IV and Nicholas Boivin.
And then we have the ballot question, which we will not read for you, but if you would like to read it, we've placed it here for you. Hopefully you got a chance to read up on the issues prior to getting there today for the marijuana retail question. So I think we're going to take a quick break, and we'll come back and we'll maybe check in back with John and move our election coverage forward. And we're back here at RCTV's election coverage on April 4th, 2017. I do think we're going to go to John Carpenter down in the field house. How's everything going down there, John?
Well, it's going pretty well. Thanks, Katie. There seems to be more participation right now. There's probably half a dozen people voting in each of the precincts, and more people coming in. So if you're not here yet, you have about 20 minutes, and want to salute the people who've been outside holding signs in the cold rain all day.
Sure.
And that's a lot of dedication, and the candidates have good friends.
You've been down there for a few hours now. It seemed to be relatively pretty steady since the camera's been on it.
Well, it's been a lot more steady for more volume since 7.
Okay.
Before 7, it was pretty sparse.
So it's looking, John, like we're going to have a last-minute rush, as typical for election, of people trying to get in before the polls close.
Yeah, I think that's happening now.
Is there anything you can tell us as having been elected in the past on, you know, what might be going through candidates' minds right now?
Well, they have anticipation. They have to think about the what if. Because, you know, you can win, you can lose. If you're confident about winning, then you're also thinking of a success speech, I guess you call it.
Yeah.
And what am I going to say? And if you lose, that's a different speech. That's, you know, thank you for my volunteers and, you know, the people have spoken and we'll do better next time.
Mm-hmm. I do think we're going to be able to talk to many of the candidates tonight. So, once 8 o'clock rolls in and we have some numbers, hopefully we'll get some people here at the studio, but we might also, you know, John might be able to speak with some people down there, I think.
We certainly welcome it. Alan Folds is here now.
Yes, good. Well, he's on the ballot for sure, so that's good.
You do that.
All right, thanks, John. We'll check in with him a little bit later, maybe. As the polls close and the numbers start to roll in, we'll bring them to you here first. We do have unofficial results, as we tell our viewers every time. The results are not official until the clerk has posted them, which usually is the next day, I believe.
Correct.
So once we get numbers, we will share them, but they will be unofficial results.
But you can catch them right here on RCTV as we continue in our coverage of the 2017 April 4th election.
Yes, and we do want to thank the volunteers, both the volunteers that are outside, as John said, holding signs in the rain, but also those that are working as election workers today. So that's really good. So we are going to take a look at Governor Baker, who stopped by Jordan's Furniture, I believe, last week to talk to the town about economic development. So let's take a look.
When people think about the question about how things are going in Massachusetts, they don't answer that question based on how they think things are going on Beacon Hill. They answer that question based on how they think things are going in their neighborhood and in their community. We have 351 cities and towns in Massachusetts, and for us to truly be successful, we have to build 351 strong communities, 351 places where people feel like things are heading in the right direction, 351 communities where people feel the possibilities and the opportunity for them and their families and their neighbors are positive and heading in the right direction.
Well, I mean, it's the annual meeting. It's great to have the governor come. You know, there are obviously chambers of commerce across the Commonwealth. You know, we're a joint chamber with two towns. I think just the very venue is a success story. As I said to somebody earlier, so if we were having this meeting 20 years ago on this location, we'd be out in a field in a grassy, with grass and vent pipes and this and that. And this is just a success story of economic development.
Well, we hope to draw a lot of attention towards the chamber, to let some of the businesses in our town, Reading, North Reading, kind of realize how we advocate for them, what some of the benefits of joining the chamber really, really are, and just to kind of grow our membership and let people know that we're out there working for business.
I think this is great to have the governor come here today. You know, we love using the IMAX Theater. Anytime that we can help the town, we really want to, because the town has just been wonderful to us. I mean, it's a great relationship, and that's not always true of a lot of businesses and towns, but I really cherish the relationship that we have with Reading.
As you know, the chambers are Reading, North Reading chambers, so North Reading's town administrator, Mike, and I are really pleased the governor could come today. It's really nice. It's especially nice that we're at Jordan's, which is a site of really positive economic development. And that's a forefront on the town's mind. I'll certainly be interested to hear some of what the constituents have to ask the governor today. I can tell you the governor uttered two words shortly after being elected that made 350 plus communities very happy, and they were Jay Ash. He reached, if you will, across the aisle, shook Jay's hand as a Democrat, and he was the first appointment he made. And that's when we knew that the governor was one of us, that he's a local guy. You know, he was a selectman. You know, it was just a much better feeling to have someone who understood our issues. All government is local. Local government sometimes has a hard time dealing with some of the bigger entities, and it's really nice to have that. So we're really thrilled to have him here today.
But the message here was, we're going to pick the best player on the field, period. Because in the end, people are policy, and you put good people in key leadership roles in a big organization, and good things happen. Second hire we made was Jay Ash, who was the city manager at Chelsea at the time, also a Democrat, to be housing and economic development secretary. And people said, why didn't you pick a business guy? Literally, a business guy. No one said a business person, they said a business guy. And I said, because Jay did $1 billion worth of economic development, housing development, downtown development, new construction, rehab development in Chelsea over the course of the previous 15 years. That's a guy who knows how to get stuff done in difficult circumstances, and he can walk the walk and talk the talk with elected officials and local officials and planners and business development people all over the Commonwealth.
So that's a good example there of local government kind of coming together. As you heard the town manager talking about Governor Baker started as a selectman up on the North Shore.
Yep.
So it's good to have that hyper-local focus and people who know what local government is all about.
Yeah, and I think today and every time we do an election here at RCTV, you know, we talk about how local government is where you can really make the changes. You know, this is a very democratic process, and, you know, it's a responsibility to take ownership of that process, and, you know, in the local government is really where you can make the major changes.
Yeah, so there's a lot, obviously, that you can do with local government, and, you know, I think it's great, especially in Reading right now, that we have the contested seats and people that want to be part.
Mm-hmm. So we are going to take a look now at some video we shot earlier today of signs in Reading today.
Election day to me is the end of a process of exploration.
It's a very important election. We have Board of Selectmen, we have school committee, which is what I'm a candidate for, as well as library and moderator for today, and the very important ballot question in regards to marijuana.
You know, I got to tell you, it's really, really inspiring because I see some of the people who come in who are disabled, wheelchairs, and they're it's crummy out, and they're coming down to vote. It is just so inspiring.
I think that this recent process has been good for the town. It's brought a lot of ideas to the surface, and you know, the voters are going to tell us how they want us to process them. And so I think that's probably the most important message I would take away from this.
Again, it's just exciting to see the citizens of Reading come out to vote. And then for myself as a worker, I've done 4 or 5, so we get a camaraderie between us. You know, so it's just really not just civic duty, it's something that I enjoy doing too.
Voter turnout has been, I would call it, slow and steady. I was in a little while ago to vote myself, and the clerk told me that it's operating at about a little over 1% an hour, so about 5 to 6% probably are out now. But the busiest time is coming as we move into the afternoon and evening hours. So
please continue to be involved in this town because it takes many hands.
Come down and vote. It's a privilege. It's it's a right, it's a responsibility, and it's something that just so many countries don't have.
You know, it's great to see so many people out there today in the crummy weather.
Yes.
you know, braving the elements to make sure that people are getting out to vote and being there as they're coming into the field house to actually go in there and cast their vote.
Yes. It looks like there were a lot of people, a lot of signs around town I've seen driving around. A lot of people out there today supporting their candidates, the candidates themselves, as we talked to a couple of them in that piece. So it's really great to see.
Local government works when people get involved. talking about people being involved, we're going to send it back to John Carpenter at the Fieldhouse. And I'm told, John, you're with Alan Folt.
Yes, Ryan, I am. Here we are in the lobby of the Fieldhouse, and I have Mr. Alan Folt, our town moderator.
Well, officially, just says moderator. School committee, selectmen, even library trustees. I don't remember the last time we had a library trustee race.
It's been years, yeah.
So how many volunteers do you think there are of the election committee here? They're doing a great job.
I don't know. It seems to be an awful lot of them in there. I have no idea, really. But it seems like there's a lot of people. There's a lot to do with this. There's 8 different precincts. And each one I know has a couple of checkers plus a couple of people checking on the way out. So maybe 8 times 4 is 32 to start with, and some probably 50, 60 maybe.
That sounds about right. And they do a great job. They're here for about 14 hours for the day?
Yep. Yeah, they showed up, they were sworn in at 6:45 this morning. And they'll be here until the vote is certified.
Right. And we'll know when the polls are closed because Laura Jem, our town clerk, will announce that the polls are closed. And then we can go into the polling place. Until then, we're out here in the lobby.
Okay. Hi, Jeff.
We're going to check the numbers on the wall. We'll go back to the studio for you.
Yes, we always.
Town hall. It's kind of exciting. We had eight different precincts, actually four different voting places, two precincts per voting place. And we would wait for the ballot boxes to be brought in. It's kind of exciting. They'd get up on the stairs and announce as each precinct came in. In fact, technically the moderator has a role here tonight, although it's really just symbolic nowadays. This is actually Article 1 at the town meeting.
It dates back
to the days when all of the elections were at the town meeting. In fact, it was 100 years ago tonight, we began electing the moderator on the ballot. Up until then, it was the first order of business to elect the moderator at the meeting.
Okay, very good.
And how many years have you been moderator now, Alan?
Thank you for all the hard work you do all year and all the endless hours that you put in to make this town work.
Okay, thank you.
Very good, thank you. So back to you in the studio, Katie and Ryan.
Thanks, John. That was great. It's really great to see Alan, being a participant in that process. And I had no idea about the moderator having a role in the election.
But then also 100 years now on the ballot that the moderator has actually been chosen at the election itself.
And I believe it has been Alan for at least a fifth of that time. So that's fantastic. I know he works very hard throughout the year on the town meetings that happened throughout the town. And he also moderated our forums this year, which was the first time in a few years that he's done the candidates' nights here.
Yeah, and did a great job moderating those forums, keeping everything running smoothly as the questions are being asked and answers are being given. Again, that's where people in the communities are getting involved in their democratic processes and making their voices heard, but also lending their time. And it's a lot of their time that they're putting forward to make sure that this community is moving forward.
So that was our first interview tonight. Hopefully we'll have some more as we've got video here of a surprised police officer, perhaps, but also the field house as they're wrapping up. We're just about 3 minutes away, I would say, from 8 o'clock. So Laura, the town clerk, will allow those people that came in at 8 o'clock to finish voting. And once they have finished voting, I believe everyone gets
removed
yes. from the premises.
So they can lock it down.
And then we and the counters will be allowed back in, where we'll hopefully get some results for you soon after 8 o'clock.
It's looking like a few people now just trickling in, you know, to get the last seconds of the vote, mm-hmm. and also some people completing their ballots there at the field house. You know, there, you can obviously see from the amount of equipment that's been set up, the volunteers that are down there have worked tirelessly. As you heard Alan mention earlier, they got sworn in at 6:45 and they've been going at it all day, making sure there's no obstacles for the people of Reading to get out there and vote.
Yeah, and I don't know about you, I saw a couple kids running around earlier on when we had this feed up before, but I always liked going with my parents to vote. It was kind of fun.
Every year, yeah.
Yeah, you know, you do the sign in as a kid. It's kind of fun to see how it all works, and you know, I don't know, mom and dad get a kind of special paper that they have to fill out, and you feed it into the machine. That
and
was
it
fun.
It instills the democratic process and you of your right and your responsibility, as we heard there in the package that we were watching, that it's a privilege and a right to be able to vote and have a say in your town elections and how your town is going to move forward.
Yeah, so I always enjoyed that. And I did see some kids running around earlier, which was what reminded me of it. And of course, you know, as an adult, it's I still do it. So
right.
Clearly it's good to bring your kids with you, maybe.
Yeah.
So there's Laura there, our town clerk. Looks like she's making some final checks before she's going to close it down right at 8 o'clock, which I think we're coming up on in just a minute or so.
Yeah, we're inside a minute now at 8 o'clock.
So she might be getting ready to kick everybody out.
Looks like she's watching her phone there on the on the clock.
Yeah. Yep. And behind her, you see those vertical strips. I believe. Oh, I think she's gonna kick everyone out right now.
And the polls have closed down there at the Walter Hawks Fieldhouse. Katie, as you were mentioning on our screen that you can see there, or just faded away, the ticker tape that's on the,
yep.
That's how the counters, if you will, that are inside the fieldhouse will get to know precinct by precinct where the votes tallied.
Yes, so hopefully we'll get some results for you soon. We'll get our team in the field house as they're coming in. I think we're gonna take a short break right now and we'll be back with some results in a little while. Covering here the 2017 blizzard of March 14th.
And this is our storm, Winter Storm Stella. You can see the eye down here, the counterclockwise spin. And we do have some intense rain heading into Cape Cod and the canal.
And the wind was blowing in my face and all the snow and everything. And I was just trying to keep my composure on the camera. It was a lot more difficult than I anticipated it being.
You want to tell us what Will has already done with?
Will is in the process of drinking a regular hot chocolate. The recipe is.
So have some food ready for that in case that happens. We're also made preparations to open an emergency shelter if we had to.
Customers can contact RMLD for outages. They can call us or they can send a message through our website.
A few of the commercial jobs are large, and we do go back to those several times, but the residential ones usually are one-time stop.
We are here in downtown Reading right now. You can see Juan Kitchen, Middlesex Animal Hospital, CVS.
So we're getting all our trucks up and running. Make sure everything is stocked properly and ready to go.
Yeah. Can you tell us anything? Why are you out here?
What's going on? I'm having fun in my Jeep.
That's cool. Thank you for the time. Yeah, so you can see from those teenage drivers out there.
You're starting to get a little bit of the cinnamon on the nutmeg.
Yeah.
You're starting to really get a good whiff of that.
I know. Doesn't it smell great?
It smells fantastic.
Yeah.
All right. Looks like about 8 inches. Pretty good. Of course, it's stripped it in some places. I'm sure it's higher here and there.
I'm at the Premier Realty and some brave walkers down the
street. It's definitely a snowball snow. You grab it in your hand and it's so heavy and dense. It is snowball snow.
Oh, that's loud. So that is definitely no false snow.
That looks like an adventure.
Oh, there we go. This is like.
Oh, God. Well, at least it doesn't look like you're moving together.
RCTV Studios offers quality summer programs for kids and teens. These programs are ideal for the budding actors and actresses of the world, as well as the future directors, sound engineers, and more. Students receive training on the most up-to-date studio equipment around, from high-definition cameras, chroma key, and Final Cut Pro, just to name a few. Workshops are available for kids and teens ages 10 to 17 and range from stop-motion animation to music videos, TV production, and filmmaking. For more information, visit www.rctv.org.
To quote English journalist and author Caitlin Moran, libraries are cathedrals of the mind, hospitals of the soul, theme parks of the imagination. On a cold, rainy island, they are the only sheltered public spaces where you are not a consumer, but a citizen instead. A citizen, part of a community, a person.
The Reading Library is like right in the center of my heart because I've worked here for 35 years, and from when we were in the little Carnegie space that was connected to the, it's now part of the town hall, and moving here once and then renovating that building and moving here again, renovating this building again, it's been, you know, it's sort of the centerpiece of my career, really, for, in terms of me. I think the rest of the community really seems excited to be here today, and I'm so glad that we have, that Reading has invested in having a really great space for families and children, because the library is a space for children to really start learning and for us to help parents become their children's first teachers. And it's free. And we're open a lot of hours, you know, till 9 at night, on the weekends. So, you know, we're a great resource for families.
It's really great to be here today. And the main reason is every library, ribbon cutting or groundbreaking, is like a very, very welcome and happy wedding.
So the ribbon cutting was really just the first in a series of events that really opened up the building to the community. We wanted to have an official opening, get ourselves up and running, but in addition to the tours, which will be going ongoing actually throughout the fall and probably into the new year, we expect to be able to have celebrations focused on the children's room, the teen space, the history room. Something for everybody, something to thank all the people who donated their time and even some of their money to make this a better place and a better building. So it's really just the kickoff of a whole year of celebration. The whole project was probably from just the imagining of it to its fruition was about 10 years. So it seems like we could spend a year celebrating an effort that took us that long to get there.
As the United States leads the world, I think Massachusetts leads the country, and I would have to say that Reading leads Massachusetts.
So it's been almost exactly 2 years since we had to move out of the 64 Middlesex Ave and over to 80 General Way, and it was really, really challenging. We went from 30,000 square feet to about 13,000 square feet, and we had to provide the same services. So it was very challenging, but we met a lot of great new friends. I think we met new people that had never heard of the Reading Public Library. We met people who didn't understand what a library was. We were able to provide them with opportunities to learn and to grow, to print out a resume, to learn how to cook or learn better English. So it was a really great opportunity for us to reach more of our community. And it was also a time when the staff could take make some time to make plans. They could think about what we wanted to do in this great new space that we were going to have. So it was really great for both the staff and the community.
Welcome back to RCTV's election coverage. It's April 4th, 2017. The election happened today between 7 and 8 p.m. So the polls just closed a few minutes ago.
10 minutes past poll closing.
10 minutes past. If you've been watching our live feed from the field house, they're packing everything up. They're organizing things. They've already kicked people out, and as evidenced by the fact that we're in there, they've let people back in. So they're getting ready to give us some numbers soon, and we'll bring them to you as soon as we have them.
Yep, so at this point, we are all waiting. We have our correspondents down at the Walter Hawks Fieldhouse that will be relaying the numbers back to us and to get them out to you, our viewers, as quickly as we can. And then everything will start to fall into place and we'll know how the election's unofficial results as they come in. But we will get those numbers to you as quick as we can. As we see here, those ticker tapes are going up on the bleachers in the field house, and those are what's going to read out the results that we have from the election tonight.
Yes, we have several crew members down there tonight. We have there's Alan, actually, who's an RCTV crew member in another life, not his today life, which is as moderator, but John Carpenter, you just saw there with the headset. We have a technical team back there and a couple of counters. Ernie Bay and Steve Crook, who are RCTV members. And you can see here the election workers packing up after their very long day.
So as soon as we get numbers as they come in, we will bring them to you.
We'll do a precinct by precinct breakdown, which is what we bring you every election. And the three the contested races this evening are the Board of Selectmen, the Tool School Committee, and the Library Board.
Correct.
There's two uncontested races for moderator and RMLD board, and there is the ballot question on marijuana retail establishments.
So we will report to you all those numbers as they come in. But at this point, we are in a holding pattern.
Yep.
Hurry up and wait to try to see when we get those numbers in there. Obviously, we want to get them to you as accurately as we have them as they're coming off the board there, down there at the Walter Hawks Fieldhouse. But again, a big shout out to our crew that's down there at the Fieldhouse, getting us all those numbers as they come in, working very hard. With John Carpenter coming to us live from the Fieldhouse. And the rest of the crew that's down there bringing you these pictures from the field house as we have it right now. As you see in the screen there, the ticker tape is up. Folks are in there looking at the numbers, trying to look precinct by precinct, race by race. Who is going to come out on top of this April 4th election? And where are we going to fall on the ballot question as well?
Yes. So we'll leave you with this live feed, and we'll be back with RCTV's election coverage just as soon as we have results. All right, I think we're back, and we might have some results for you here from the field house on today's election. So we'll be bringing those to you right now. Let's see. So in Precinct 3, our breakdown is John Halsey, 143, Kevin Sexton, 137, and Andrew Friedman, 203 for the two seats on the Board of Selectmen three-year seat.
And again, these are unofficial results as we're getting them in down from the field house.
We will bring you as many results as quickly as we can. So for right now, I believe this is all that we have, but we'll be bringing more just as soon as we have them. As you can see here, folks are still counting and anxiously awaiting a tally for this evening's vote throughout the town of Reading. Again, as we said, there are 8 precincts, so we'll be breaking down the results per race, per precinct, again, unofficially. And we'll also make sure to remind you for how long that seat is going to be.
So as you see there, folks up along the stands inside the field house, trying to capture numbers precinct by precinct, as we brought you there, the selectman result for precinct 3, as we have them in currently. So folks working right there to get those numbers, relay them back to us here in the studio so we can bring those to you. And as we get those in here, we will bring them to you on the screen.
All right, it looks like we might have some more results to share You can see actually a couple of our workers right there with the clipboard. Steve's getting results for us. So in addition to that Precinct 3 results, we also have their school committee.
So this is for the three-year seat on the school committee, and the results as we have them currently is Jean Borowski with 187 votes, Linda Snow-Doxer with 167 votes, and Erin Calvobacci coming in right now with 152 votes in Precinct 3 for the three-year school committee seat.
That is an incredibly close race.
Very close.
For the Board of Library Trustees in Precinct 3, Ruth Doucette has 119, Nina Pinacchio 115, and Sherry Vandenacker 157, another very close race for second and third.
And as we went over before, for the Board of Selectmen seat, the for a three-year term in Precinct 3, we have John Halsey with 143 votes, Kevin Sexton with 137 votes, and Andrew Friedman with 203 votes, reporting right now out of Precinct 3.
The ballot question in Precinct 3 on the marijuana establishment ban, yes, 212, no, 83. That is a resounding, the only resounding answer out of the, the results we've seen.
Right, and again, to remind on that, the marijuana establishment ban, a yes vote would be to ban marijuana retail establishments coming into the town of Reading, and a no would be for to allow them in the town of Reading.
Correct. The school committee seat, again, as we've seen this, we saw this just a minute ago, for Precinct 3, Jean Borowski, 187, Linda Snow-Doxer, 167, and Erin Calvobacci, a not distant at all third in 152.
Yeah, we've seen some tight races here. Just like the top two here, Ruth Doucette and Nina Pinacchio, with 119 and 115 respectively, and Sherry Vandenacker with 157 votes for the library trustees.
So I believe that's all of the contested races for Precinct 3, and I would say that they are all very close. If that's going to be the way of the rest of the voting results, which hopefully we'll bring you soon, very close.
Yeah, it can come down to the wire here in a lot of those races, depending, you know, it's one of eight precincts that we have here in the town of Reading. And once we get the other seven precincts, things will start to become a little bit clearer. But as of right now, those numbers, as you saw them, unofficial, obviously, as we're getting them in here to the studio. But yeah, definitely some close races.
Yeah, and I think this was an election where a lot of people were vocal. I saw lots on Facebook for people talking about various candidates and really getting interested in the issues. At the forums we were at, the budget was a major topic for discussion. The running of the schools was a major topic of discussion. So I think there are a lot of issues near and dear to people's hearts that are coming up in these elections.
Yeah, and I think, you know, it's good that folks in the town of Reading are caring about these issues and want to have a say in that process of how this is going to move forward. And this is exactly in the democratic process, the way that you do that with your local government, your elected officials, and especially, you know, as we covered, we sat here and covered the special election for the override that failed. We are, you know, there's a lot of other things that are at stake here in these elections.
Yes, the last contested race in Precinct 3 is for the two-year seat on the school committee. Carl Anderson with 105 votes and Nicholas Boivin with 143. Again, unofficial, again, close. So I believe that's everything for Precinct 3. I misspoke earlier.
Just, you know, just in case you missed them earlier, we'll keep rolling these numbers for you in case you're checking in on your precinct or you're just joining us. We're looking at the numbers here for Precinct 3 for the three-year Board of Selectmen seat. And now switching over here to the marijuana establishment ban in Precinct 3. That's 212 yes votes, which would ban marijuana establishments from being in the town of Reading, and 83 no votes.
Correct. And the school committee three-year seat in Precinct 3, very tight race between Jean Borowski, Linda Snow-Doxer, and Erin Calvobacci, as you can see.
And here again for the Board of Library Trustees in Precinct 3, Ruth Doucette with 119 votes, Nina Pinacchio with 115 votes, and Sherry Vandenacker with 157 votes for the Board of Library Trustees in Precinct 3. As we get more precincts that are going to roll in, we will go over those results. But as you see here, the two-year school committee seat between Carl Anderson IV and Nicholas Boivin the 143 votes there for Nicholas Boivin and Carl Anderson, the fourth, with 105 votes.
And hopefully as more results come in and as the evening progresses a little bit, we'll get some of the candidates in. We might be able to speak with them about running their campaign and how this evening has gone for them once we know a little more and they know a little more.
Right. Still very early on in the stages here, so we will be getting those results in for you here at RCTV in our election coverage. As soon as we know them, we will put them up on the screen for you. As things are keep rolling in with our folks working pretty tirelessly down there at the field house, trying to see what the outcome of this election is going to be.
Yeah, so we'll be back with more results soon.
And we're back here at RCTV Studios bringing you election coverage on this April 4th election here in the town of Reading. We are awaiting new election results as they come in. We've just seen Precinct 3's results. And we are waiting for other precincts to weigh in, and I believe we have some here.
So here, Precinct 5's Board of Selectmen results are in. John Halsey with 150 votes, Kevin Sexton, 158 votes, and Andrew Friedman, 276 votes. Friedman there is the challenger for the two incumbents, and Halsey and Sexton only separated by 8 votes there.
For the school committee, the two-year seat, you have Carl Anderson with 116 votes and Nicholas Boivin with 180 votes in Precinct 5.
For the three-year seat on the school committee, two candidates getting seats, Jean Borowski, 222 votes, Linda Snow-Doxer, 216 votes, and Aaron Calvobacci, 183 votes. I believe that's all we've got right now. Again, those are unofficial results. It seems to be a very close vote from the results for Precinct 3 and Precinct 5.
Yeah, I think that's what we're going to see here throughout the remainder of the night as the other precincts come rolling in.
So it really is going to be a last-minute, down-to-the-wire decision, it seems like. Right. So we will be bringing results to you here, precinct by precinct, as we have been doing just as soon as we get them. You can see here we've got a live look at the field house. They seem to have packed up a lot of their materials.
Yep, at the end of a very long day for them. Yes. 6:45 a.m. is when the poll workers were sworn in, and now getting to the end of their day here. And as we have some, obviously our crew down there at the field house looking at some of the candidates that are inside there after seeing the results coming in. And like I said, we'll have those results for you as we get them.
Some very happy folks down there at the field house, which is wonderful to see. So that is, as I said, a live look in at the field house. People still counting up the votes. This might be a good time to talk about RCTV as a service for the community.
Yeah, good times ever.
Yeah. So Ryan and I both serve on the board of directors here at RCTV, which is a really great opportunity for us to serve the community and also use this as a great opportunity to help the organization.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a great experience to be part of something in the town of Reading that provides a great service to the town of Reading and is really great active members of the community as well.
Yes, RCTV was at the Taste of Metro North just last week. Obviously, the election coverage. This is a very busy season with the candidate forums and the candidate statements. And all of the prep that goes into that. We have a big crew for tonight. Multiple cameras, as you can see, both here in the studio and at the field house. So it takes a lot of volunteers to make that happen. We have high schoolers here tonight, and we have members that have been a part of RCTV for decades. So
yeah, you know, and we strive to do our best to bring you the best coverage of all of these local elections so we can get our viewers all the information that you need as quickly as possible.
Yes, we do have summer workshops in the summer, which a lot of the kids are really excited about. A 3-week program where you create a movie, and then many short 2-day and 3-day workshops to create music videos and things like that. So for more information about RCTV, rctv.org. And I think we'll take a brief break and then we'll come back with more election results when we have them. All right, I think we've got John down at the field house. John, who have you got with you? John? Hi, John. How are you?
Doing fine. Are
Great.
We on?
Great. You are, yes. Who have you got with you?
I have Carl Anderson here, school committee candidate. And if you want to have a few words about how your campaign went and what you learned from it.
Well, I think that it was definitely a great learning experience. I think that everybody that got out and supported me did a great work. Holding signs in the rain today was very cold, so I want to thank everybody that came out and did that. It was a grueling campaign, and I'm glad to finally get some rest. And I definitely hope as a young guy I can inspire the young people to get out and get involved. It's very important to get involved in our town.
Thank you very much. And you know, just with this one election, this does not excuse you from future duties, because now you've stepped forward.
Well, I think that I'm going to seek a seat in the school committee next year for sure. And in the meantime, I definitely am going to be staying involved in our town.
Thank you very much, and we look forward to hearing a lot more from you.
Thank you. I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thanks, John. That was great. Carl Anderson IV on the school committee ballot for today for the 2-year seat up against Nicholas Boivin. So from the, I believe from the two precincts we saw, he was trailing, but again, it was a very close race.
Yeah, absolutely. I think a lot of the races that we're seeing here tonight are close races, and will continue to be close races as we're going to bring you precinct by precinct the election results.
No, that's a good
Yeah, so we've got two precincts in, at least partially. I believe we have all of precincts 3 and partial of precinct 5. So there's still many results to come. It has been a long day for those volunteers, and it continues to be a long day. And as Carl said, there were people standing outside with signs that we've talked about. Here we have some results on Precinct 5 for the marijuana establishment ban, 222 yeses and 141 noes. Again, these are unofficial results. Well, they are not official until the town clerk has certified them.
And again, with this question going and passing or getting a yes vote, that will send it to the town meeting to look at the zoning restrictions in the town of Reading and if there's going to be changing in the zoning to have marijuana establishments banned from the town of Reading.
Yes.
I was wondering what would
Board of Trustees in Precinct 5, Ruth Doucette, 128 votes, Nina Panacchio, 135 votes, and Sherry Vandenacker with 196 votes.
So Precinct 3 to Precinct 5, we've seen a switch. And
they
want to talk to you
after they have all the results on the screen. So
here
we want to talk to not candidates.
Precinct 5 at the moment.
Very close.
Okay. If that's okay. Yeah. That's what they have.
That might be all that we have for you right now. That was a great interview that John just had with Carl.
How would you feel
it's nice
if you
to
had
see someone so young, still in college, really excited about local politics and getting involved.
Yeah, definitely. I think it's something where the youth in the town of Reading are starting to get involved and have some pride in their town to be able to get involved and make a difference from that point of view. I think it's great to see young people getting involved in that civic process.
Yes, and as you heard from Carl, it sounds like regardless of what happens tonight, which is in no way decided at this point, we can't call it in any direction, he will be continuing to be involved in local politics.
And you love that. We've stated it before on this program, but it all starts with local politics. Getting involved on that local level, it's really where you can make changes and make a difference within your own community.
Yep. So a lot happening here today on a crummy day when it was cold and I had a lot of people wanted to stay in bed and not go to work and not go to vote. But it sounds like the percentages we have to turn out is better than usual.
Yeah, that's a good thing. One for the school committee. For the three-year seat, we have Jean Borowski with 292 votes, Linda Snow-Doxer with 355 votes, and Erin Calvobacci with 257 votes. Again, all these results coming in from the field house, unofficial at this time.
Yes, they should be. I believe that Laura turns them around pretty quickly. I think that it's tomorrow or the next day. For that two-year seat on the school committee, Nicholas Boivin, 222, leading Carl Anderson IV, who we just spoke to, John Carpenter down at the field house, 183. So the other contested seat that we're waiting for there is the library board, I believe. I don't believe we saw that for precinct one. So we'll get that as soon as we can. It takes a long time to count up that many votes, I'll tell you.
Well, especially if you have good voter turnout for your town and it comes in, it's going to take a while to tally those votes. And as soon as we have them here at RCTV, we will bring them to you. And again, we have our live feed here from the Walter Hawks Fieldhouse as our RCTV members are down there tallying up those votes and sending them back to us here in the studio to bring them to you, our viewers. There's a lot of numbers on that ticker tape that is up there on the bleachers. So there's a lot of calculating, a lot of other things that are going on to get those numbers back to us here in the studio. Back here in the studio at RCTV, bringing you election coverage. And we're waiting on the more numbers to come in from the field house as our folks are down there tallying those and sending them back up to us to get them on the screen here to get you the totals. So as you see here, we're looking at the Board of Library Trustees for Precinct 1. Ruth Doucette had 182 votes, Nina Panacchia with 274 votes, and Sherry Vandenaker with 183 votes. This seems, from a lot of the different precincts, there's been some flip-flopping of who has gotten the votes here for the Board of Library Trustees.
Yes, I agree. And also, again, incredibly close. I mean, one vote difference between Doucette and Vandenacker there. And then here we have the marijuana establishment ban for Precinct 1. Yes vote for 381. No vote, 142. So I would say on the ballot question for the three precincts we've seen at this point, it is a yes tally.
It's been overwhelmingly yes. You know, it seems like Precinct 1 is also a lot of folks come out to vote.
The numbers that we've seen here,
a lot of high numbers on that precinct alone from what we've seen from Precinct 3, Precinct 5, and now Precinct 1.
Yes. I don't know what the voter final percentages were after 8 o'clock, but I believe it was probably around 17%, so a little higher than average for a local election. I think that probably has a lot to do with the multiple contested races for this, this round. I know the last time I did an RCTV coverage that wasn't the override, there were no contested races, so it was a low voter turnout and not a whole lot of surprises.
Right. But with this election, as you said, you know, contested seats. So we now have in Precinct 2 for the Board of Selectmen, a three-year seat, John Halsey with 155 votes, Kevin Sexton with 142 votes, and Andrew Friedman coming in with 198 votes.
So a bit of a lower total, perhaps, than Precinct 1, but still close. For the three-year seat for the school committee in Precinct 2, Jean Borowski, 178 votes, Linda Snow-Doxer, 190 votes, and Erin Calvobacci, 149 votes.
So we see here that the votes are coming in. This is Precinct 2. We've now heard from Precinct 3, Precinct 5, Precinct 1, and now Precinct 2. These results, as we're getting them in, obviously unofficial until the town clerk declares them official.
Yes, and here we are again with the Board of Selectmen for Precinct 2, which we just read out. Again, too close to call. Kevin Sexton and John Halsey separated by only 7 votes. Again, this seat, the Board of Selectmen, there's 2 victors out of the 3 contestants. Or out of the 3 candidates. Thank you, contestants. Candidates. Thank you. So it's going to be a tight race between 2nd and 3rd, I would say.
And we see here now coming in from Precinct 2 for the 2-year seat on the school committee, Carl Anderson with 90 votes and Nicholas Boivin with 148 votes there in Precinct 2.
Yes, so a bigger split there than with the other school committee seat at this point. So we'll continue to get results in. I think we've got 4 precincts in, so just about half. So we'll get the other half just as soon as they come in. And we'll be back at RCTV's election coverage.
We're gonna go back down to the field house where John Carpenter is with our town clerk. John.
Yeah. Thank you, Ryan. This is John Carpenter's field house, which is really thinning out. But I'm here with our town clerk, Mrs. Lorchem. And Laura, how do you think it went this time?
It was a very smooth running election. We had 3,331 ballots with a 17.5% turnout. Would have liked to have seen that number a little bit higher, but it was for the voters, it turned out it was a very smooth election.
Well, thank you. So 17.5%? Great. Well, thank you for the 17.5% that showed up, and the rest of you show up next time. Thank you. Back to the studio.
Thanks, John. So there you have it. 17.5% of the town of Reading registered voters showed up today to vote, which for a local election is kind of right around what you would expect. Obviously, as Laura said there, with contested seats, you always want to see more
Come
out to vote. But I believe right around 3,319, I believe, was the number that came. A good turnout for that. So we're going to take a break now, and we'll be back with more election coverage here on RCTV.
On the menu today, we have Roman-style lamb with artichokes, barley pilaf, and thick and creamy yogurt-filled crepes. So let's get started.
This is my first production, and we like doing it. We really do. It's enjoyable.
I enjoy the creativity because it's an artistic presentation and we get to have good food and share it with the community.
I love the people here, getting the camaraderie of the editing and the taping, and it's great. It's wonderful.
I definitely would encourage others to get involved. It's a great experience. The staff and everyone here has really been very supportive.
For more information about RCTV, visit us on the web at www.rctv.org.
In Reading. We're covering here the 2017 blizzard of March 14th.
And this is our storm, Winter Storm Stella. You can see the eye down here, the counterclockwise spin, and we do have some intense rain heading into Cape Cod in the canal.
And the wind was blowing in my face and all the snow and everything, and I was just trying to keep my composure on the camera. It was a lot more difficult than I anticipated it being.
You want to tell us what Will has already done with?
Will is in the process of drinking a regular hot chocolate. The recipe is...
So have some food ready for that in case that happens. We're also made preparations to open an emergency shelter if we had to.
Customers can contact RMLD for outages. They can call us or they can send a message through our website.
A few of the commercial jobs are large, and we do go back to those several times, but the residential ones usually are one-time stop.
Well, we are here in downtown Reading right now. You can see Juan Kitchen, Middlesex Animal Hospital, CVS, Venetian.
So we're getting all our trucks up and running. Make sure everything is stocked properly and ready to go.
Yeah. Can you tell us anything? Why are you out here?
What's going on? Having some fun in my Jeep.
That's cool. Thank you for the time. Yeah, so you can see from those teenage drivers out there.
You're starting to get a little bit of the cinnamon on the nutmeg. Yeah. You're starting to really get a good whiff of that.
I know. Doesn't it smell great?
It smells fantastic.
Yeah.
All right. Looks like about 8 inches. Pretty good. Of course, it's drifted in some places. I'm sure it's higher here and there.
Cam at the Premier Realty and some brave walkers down the street.
It's definitely a snowball snow. You grab it in your hand and it's so heavy and dense. It is snowball snow.
So that is definitely snowball snow.
That looked like an adventure.
Oh, there we go. This is like.
Oh, God. Okay. Well, at least it doesn't look like you're moving to the
Saturday Night Lights is a flag football program that we started back in 2012. It's an opportunity for kids, boys and girls, from grades kindergarten all the way up through the eighth grade to come out here on a Saturday night. A low-key atmosphere, a fun atmosphere. We have some music playing. It's under the lights. The kids get a chance to play and have fun in a very fast, competitive sport, but also one where parents and coaches have it in perspective and allow the kids to have fun first. Yeah, we started out in 2012 with about 125 kids, and we're up over 700 this year, and we're active in six other surrounding towns. So the word has spread, and we find the enrollment of older kids is happening quite frequently, as well as the girls group. The female enrollment is doubling every year. So all the way from kindergarten up through the seventh and eighth grade girls, you know, they really enjoy themselves too. So I think it's a great sport for kids, boys and girls of all ages.
I think that Jimmy runs a great program. He has a lot of good coaches, a bunch of great kids who want to play or into the game, who want to have fun. They see all their friends, his DJ. It's all good.
Yeah, we have a lot of fun. I think the aspect that my family enjoys is that it is family friendly and it's casual. Where there's so much competition in sports nowadays, kids can come out. You know, for us, our daughters are playing football. I never would have imagined that they would want to play the sport. And it's exciting that they can, you know, just play something in a casual, fun, friendly environment. And also, I think for a lot of the coaches that can't maybe coach a team like full time throughout the season, you get an opportunity to coach their kids and their kids' friends. And have a good time doing it.
Go get it, Scotty! Come on, Scotty! Come on, Scotty! Ah. All right.
Coaches are all volunteers, moms and dads from all the grades that offer to come out, and they get quite creative with the play calling, and they seem to have a lot of fun with it as well. We hire the high school players to come out here so they have an opportunity to make some money and be, you know, in a safe environment on a Saturday night. A lot of them are high school football players, so they, you know, the youth of the community can look up to the high school kids and go to their games on Friday nights, and sort of they can develop their own following. They're very energetic, very enthusiastic, and the younger kids look up to the high school football players. So I think it's a win-win in that respect. Well, I think football is such a popular sport in general in New England, especially with the success the Patriots are having. Reading High School certainly has the best football program in the state. And parents are looking for a fun, safe alternative to have their kids participate. And when they're ready to play Pop Warner and put the pads on and learn the physical part of the game, they can certainly do so. And this gives them a nice feeder system to do that. I just really appreciate the turnout. I really appreciate the you know, Nick Face and Barry Ermer and the folks that help us out, and you know, and all the parents that continue to come year after year to enjoy themselves. It's really a special program and a great community event.
All right, we're back here on RCTV's election coverage. Ryan, it's been an exciting night so far.
It has been. I'm moved over to a different part of the studio here. We're going to continue this program rolling forward. It has been an exciting evening for us in the election coverage as the numbers continue to roll in from Hawks Fieldhouse. We are getting our numbers from our crew down there at the Fieldhouse. As we get them in here, Katie and I will be delivering them to you, our viewers, and it looks like we have some more numbers here.
So for Precinct 4, we have results for the Board of Selectmen race. John Halsey with 167 votes, Kevin Sexton with 188 votes, and Andrew Friedman with 339 votes.
And for the school committee for the three-year seat in Precinct 4, Gene Borowski with 281 votes, Linda Snow-Doxer with 301 votes, and Aaron Calvo-Bacci with 185 votes.
For the two-year seat on that school committee spot, we have Carl Anderson with 141 votes and Nicholas Boivin with 196 votes.
And for the Board of Library Trustees in Precinct 4, Ruth Doucette tallied 163 votes, Nina Pinocchio with 140 votes, and Sherry Vandenecker with 239 votes.
And the ballot question on the marijuana establishment ban, 305 yes votes and 139 no votes. So again, many of those races close.
Yeah, they have been close all night as we're getting the numbers in. There can't really say there's one far and away favorite as we've looked at the numbers that have come in so far with us. At least we haven't done so much of the calculating on our end quite yet, but we have seen races that lots of votes that are coming in from the different precincts. We've now have five of the eight precincts reporting, of course, unofficial votes at this point until the town clerk says that they are official, but we are having some tight races as it comes up.
Yes, and we had that conversation with John Carpenter and Laura, the town clerk, just a few moments ago. You can see her hard at work, and as she said, the turnout was good, but she always hopes for more.
Yeah, 17.5%, I think, you know, in a local election, that's kind of on par for what they're expecting, but when you have so many contested seats, you're looking for a higher voter turnout, and as John said, thank you to the 17.5% that turned out, and next time the rest of the voters will come out for that one.
Yeah, I believe the turnout was a little higher for the override that we covered in the special election last October, but I can't remember the exact numbers, so that could be incorrect.
Well, you know, you're looking at some contested seats here for the school committee and for the Board of Selectmen. These are high-touch positions that are really affecting the community moving forward. So I think a lot of people wanted to come out, get out and vote. Volunteers were holding signs in the middle of their communities and on the grounds of the Fieldhouse today. So we looking here, we do have more results in for you. In Precinct 6, for the two-year seat in the school committee, Carl Anderson with 111 votes and Nicholas Boivin with 129 votes.
For the three-year seat in Precinct 6, the votes are in for Gene Borowski in the amount of 218, Linda Snow-Doxer 165, and Aaron Calvo-Bacci 127.
As we look for the Board of Selectmen in Precinct 6, John Halsey with 144 votes, Kevin Sexton with 141 votes, and Andrew Friedman coming in with 189 votes in Precinct 6.
The Board of Library Trustees in Precinct 6, Ruth Doucette, 114, Nina Pinocchio, very close, 116, and Sherry Vandenacker, 124. All
so
three
very,
of those very close.
Very close there for the Library Trustees.
Within 10.
And again, that's Precinct 6 that we're looking at. And looking at the marijuana establishment ban vote, the yeses were 194 to the noes 99. On that ballot question one on the ballot today.
So So as we get more results in, it does seem like the ballot question has been voted yes. I think, again, unofficially and not having seen the last two precincts, but I think for the first six, which I believe we have in now, it seems like a yes on that.
Yeah, unofficially, that's the way it seems like the numbers have gone so far. And again, that ballot question is if a vote on yes with that, it would move to the town meeting for a vote of new zoning laws to prevent any marijuana retail establishment from being erected in the town of Reading.
Yes, and I don't believe that that vote has anything to do with the vote that was approved last November related to marijuana. I believe this is just on retail establishments.
Correct.
That seems to be in, and then we have some more here for Precinct 7. For the two-year seat, Carl Anderson, 167 votes, and Nick Boivin with 228 votes. So a bit of a wider split there.
And carrying on in Precinct 7 for the three-year school committee seat, we see Gene Borowski with 289 votes, Linda Snow-Doxer with 295 votes, and Erin Calvo-Bacci with 191 votes.
The Board of Selectmen in Precinct 7, John Halsey, 188 votes, Kevin Sexton with 209 votes, and Andrew Friedman with 325 votes.
For Precinct 7, the Board of Library Trustees, Ruth Doucette with 210 votes, Nina Pinocchio with 162 votes, and Sherry Vandenacre with 177 votes there in Precinct 7.
And the marijuana establishment ban in Precinct 7, 334 yes votes, and 133 no votes. And I do believe we're going to take a break, so we'll be back in just a minute with more results. All right, and we're back with RCTV's coverage. Ryan, I think you have a guest.
I do. Joining me over here in our second set of the studio is a candidate for the Board of Selectmen, Andrew Friedman. Welcome in.
Hi, how you doing?
Great. So, Andrew, talk to me about how today went. And I know there's a lot that goes into today, but talk to me a little bit about that.
Well, the day itself was very wet and very cold, but it was very energizing. I'm very grateful to all the many people who came out and held signs throughout the day, in spite of the weather. I'm grateful to the people who came out and voted.
So, I know in the forum you talked about that there was a lot of people that were on your team to put the election together. What would you like to say to those folks?
Well, a very heartfelt expression of gratitude towards them. I was amazed at the level of energy that they brought to the table, the level of passion, intelligence, and knowledge, advice that they gave. And many people worked very hard to get out the vote through all sorts of media, email, phone calls, talking to the neighbors. It was really very actually humbling.
And how was it standing out there today in the, obviously not the greatest weather on election day?
It was, like I said, it was wet and cold, but it was kind of exciting. I found that I liked waving to people as they drove by. It was fun talking to the people holding the signs. They obviously care a lot about their community, and I learned a lot.
And what do you think is your, from today and the whole experience so far, what has been your biggest takeaway as of yet?
So I think my takeaway is that in listening to the community and people that have said they were happy that I was running and supported me, that I think that we need a change of tone from both the selectmen and from town hall.
So, thank you for coming in and joining us
thank
here today
much.
At RCTV. I'm going to kick it back over to Katie in our other set.
Thanks, Ryan, and thank you to Andrew for that excellent interview. We love having candidates come in, and I'm in fact sitting with one now. Hi, Alan.
Hi,
so I'm here with Alan Folds. I think we can unofficially say congratulations, as you were the only one running. Yeah. So we saw you talking to John earlier. I'm not sure if you heard. I asked how many years this makes for you as our town moderator.
This is my 21st term.
Congratulations. And Ryan and I were both surprised by the fact you gave us about, you know, 100 years today.
Right.
Voting for
the first 200 and some odd years, we used to elect moderators at the town meeting. It's the first order of business, mm-hmm. which explains why the moderator is still at the top of the ballot. It's just an old tradition. But 1907, the state allowed towns to elect the moderator on the ballot. Before that, they had to elect it at the town meeting. And Reading accepted it 10 years later, and since 1917, that's the way we've done it.
You're always here with our local facts, which is good because you always learn a little tidbit, or at least I do. So today, I'm sure, was like many other elections for you, a little rainier than usual, perhaps?
A little rainier than usual. I have been going to the election nights since I first moved to town, long before I got involved and everything. It's, to me, it's one of the best nights in town. Whether there's candidates running or not, it makes it a little more exciting when there's contests, but it's just a great night. Even the, everybody is involved, whether you win or you lose. People are out here volunteering mm-hmm. their time. It's really a nice day.
Well, and it's great to see contested races because, you know, it shows that people are getting involved. It shows that, you know, people are interested in the issues and how they can help. And I think we have more results right here, actually. So for the school committee for the two-year seat, Carl Anderson IV, 136 votes, and Nicholas Boivin with 198 votes. So again, as we've mentioned, these are unofficial results. Do you want to?
Oh, sure. For the three-year position on the school committee, Gene Borowski has 241, Linda Snow-Doxer, 231. Those are the incumbents. And Aaron Calvobacci, 186.
As we look here for the Board of Selectmen in Precinct 8,
John Halsey with 204 votes, Kevin Sexton with 215 votes, and Andrew Friedman with 242 votes.
And for the Board of Library Trustees in Precinct 8, Ruth Doucette with 149 votes. Very close again, Nina Pinacchia with 141 votes and Sherry Vandenacker with 156 votes.
And ballot question one, which is the only ballot question, the marijuana establishment ban. Precinct 8, the yes votes were 291 and the no votes 111.
So as Ryan and I have been talking tonight, this is a very close race so far. It seems like many of the races are pretty close, which is exciting because it shows that the candidates are, you know, prepared and getting out into the community.
Right. I was looking at the unofficial results, and it's really close in a couple of the races, yeah.
And also, in your duties as moderator this year, you took on our candidates' nights, which was great. It was great to have a moderator there at RCTV as well.
Oh, thank you. That was a lot of fun, actually.
Yeah, I thought the set for that was particularly good.
And they all did a good job. It was, I actually didn't even hear them. You know, I'm sure like you, you're so wrapped up in the mechanics of it. I had to watch them later to actually hear what the candidates said.
Well, yeah, and with you keeping track of time and who gets to speak next, it does get kind of mechanical.
Right,
And with Ryan and I's minds and John Carpenter's prescribed set of questions, for me particularly, I'm making sure that I don't trip over my words.
Well, you all three of you did a great job.
Thank you.
They were very informative. It was really, this station does such a good job with local coverage.
Thank you. Ryan, that was your first night doing Candidates Nights too, I believe, right?
It was. It was fun asking the questions and fun kind of getting to pose the questions to the selecting candidates that the town would like to know about. And through those questions, we had user-submitted questions or town citizen-submitted questions that were added into that as well. So a good opportunity for the people of Reading to be able to put their questions out there for the candidates to answer, to really give them the best sense of who they're voting for and where they stand on the issues that we ask them about.
Yeah, so as you just saw, our live look at the field house, it's really emptied out now. before when we had it on there, when we went live at 7:30, it was pretty bustling with workers and everything. It looks like those well strong volunteers have mostly been able to go home. We are going to take a break now, but we'll be back with more results just as soon as we have them. So we're back here with RCTV's coverage of the April 4th, 2017 election. We've gotten a fair amount of results in. We're still waiting on a few more. I'm back here with Ryan at our main set.
Made my way back over to the main set here. It's top notch here at RCTV. We've got different sets. But it's one of the big things that we do this for RCTV is the election coverage. And I think one of the duties that we see as members that are sitting on the board to bring the election coverage to you right into your homes, the viewers on election night. So to be able to provide this. And it looks like right now we are going to go down to the field house and talk to John Carpenter, who has been working hard for us all night getting the numbers. What do you have, John?
Thank you, Ryan. All the results are posted, as you see here. And most of the volunteers and the people been working all day are gone. It's very quiet. And so we're going to sign off here at the field house. And we'll toss it back to the studio. We'll maybe do one more pan around so you can see how deserted the place is. This is John Carpenter signing off from the Hawks field house.
Thank you very much, John, for all your coverage tonight for the April 4th election here, and all the crew down there as well at the Hawks Fieldhouse, bringing us our numbers, bringing you those live shots that we've seen all night since we've been on the air. A lot of work gets put into that, and a lot of stuff that goes on behind the scenes to bring that to you, our viewers.
Yes, we do have a few cameras down there. You may have seen one of our high schoolers walking around with the body cam on, which he also wore for our blizzard coverage about a week ago. So we do have some, so we've seen these results before. These are for the Board of Selectmen for Precinct 3. John Halsey, 143, Kevin Sexton, 137, and Andrew Friedman, who we just spoke with, 203.
On the marijuana establishment ban ballot question, the yes votes are 212 and the no's are 83.
For the school committee seat, for the three-year seat in Precinct 3, is Jean Borowski, 187 votes, Linda Snow-Doxer, 167 votes, and Aaron Calvobacci, 152 votes.
Board of Library Trustees in Precinct 3, Ruth Doucette, got 119 votes, Nina Pinocchio, 115, and Sherry Vandenacre with 157 votes.
For the two-year seat in the school committee, Carl Anderson IV got 105 votes, and Nicholas Boivin got 143 votes.
Moving along to Precinct 5 in the Board of Selectmen race for that three-year seat, John Halsey collected 150 votes, Kevin Sexton collected 158 votes, while Andrew Friedman collected 276 votes.
In the two-year seat for the school committee, Carol Anderson IV got 116 votes, and Nicholas Boivin got 180 votes.
And again, these are unofficial results, but for the school committee in Precinct 5 for the three-year seat, Jean Borowski with 222 votes, Linda Snow-Doxer with 216 votes, and Aaron Calvobacci with 183 votes.
On that marijuana establishment ban in Precinct 5, yes, 222 votes, no votes, 141.
The Board of Library Trustees in Precinct 5 saw Ruth Doucette get 128 votes, Nina Pinocchio get 135 votes, and Sherry Vandenacre with 196 votes.
And the Board of Selectmen for Precinct 1, John Halsey got 302 votes, Kevin Sexton 262 votes, and Andrew Friedman 299 votes.
The school committee for the three-year seat in Precinct 1, Jean Borowski with 292 votes, Linda Snow-Doxer 355 votes, and Aaron Calvobacci with a number that has now escaped us, but we'll move on to the school committee. Katie?
For the two-year seat, Carl Anderson, 183, and Nicholas Boivin, 222 in Precinct 1.
For the Board of Library Trustees in Precinct 1, Ruth Doucette with 182 votes, Nina Panacchio with 274 votes, and Sherry Vandenacre with 183 votes. Tightly contested races
tightly,
all across for
very,
the Library Trustees.
Very close. As well as in the school committee vote, 3-year seat seems to be flip-flopping precinct to precinct as well.
Right.
So hopefully we'll get totals, and I believe we're still waiting on the end results for Precinct 8. So once we get those, we'll bring them to you as soon as we can. It has been an exciting night, though.
It has been.
We've been able to speak to a couple candidates. Alan, who was the only person on the ballot for the moderator spot, Carl Anderson IV down at the Fieldhouse with John Carpenter, and we also you spoke to Andrew Friedman.
Yep. So we always love to have the candidates on the air with us during our election coverage, giving them the opportunity to speak directly to you, the voters. So it's one of the great processes that we have, and one of the great things that we have as RCTV to be able to bring in the candidates, give them that venue and the avenue to speak directly to you through the medium of television. But we also like to get to know those community members as well, a good way to be in and rolled in with the community.
Yes, and that is obviously a main tenet of RCTV, Reading Community Television, is being in with the community and bringing you these election nights. This is kind of the culmination of our busy season, I would say, at least from my perspective, after candidates' nights and prepping for this evening of live election coverage here at the studio. So it's a very exciting evening for us, and I think we have more results for you now here. Ah, totals. So these are, again, unofficial. We cannot call them official until Laura has, the town clerk has certified them, probably tomorrow. But for the Board of Selectmen, John Halsey with 1,453 votes, Kevin Sexton with 1,448 votes, and Andrew Friedman with 2,071 votes. Incredibly close there for second and third.
Very, very close. Just 5 votes unofficially separating in the Board of Selectmen seat.
Yes, that's as close as I've seen something during my tenure here at RCTV, I would say. So John Halsey and Kevin Sexton, again, were the incumbents. Andrew Friedman was new to the board, so it looks like he will be taking a seat, and it looks like John Halsey will be maintaining his seat. I believe Halsey, John Halsey is the chairman this year, outgoing chairman.
Correct.
So it looks like they have taken that role.
And looking here at the school committee, the 3-year seat, looking at the totals, Gene Borowski with 1,908 votes, Linda Snow-Doxer with 1,920 votes, and Erin Calvo-Bacci with 1,430 votes. And that is for the 3-year seat on the Reading School Committee. Again, results unofficial until they are officially official, as told by the town clerk.
The Board of Library Trustees, again, this is for 2 seats. So it looks like Ruth Doucette has unfortunately lost with 1,199 votes to Nina Panacchio with 1,218 votes and Sherry Vandenacre with 1,358 votes.
As we look for the school committee on the 2-year seat, the totals here, we have Carl Anderson with 1,049 votes and Nicholas Boivin with 1,444 votes.
So some of those closer than others, but all respectable amounts of votes, and we certainly congratulate the winners.
And we look here for ballot question 1, the one and only ballot question on this year's election. The marijuana establishment ban, the precinct totals came in as followed for the total here. The yeses with 2,130 and the noes for 931 votes.
So we're going to take a quick break. We've just showed you those unofficial results, and we'll be back in a little bit with RCTV's election coverage. All right, so I'm back here with Nick Boivin. Congratulations, unofficially, on your win tonight.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, so we spoke last at the Candidates Forum, the Selectman Candidates Forum. Of course, you went up against Carl Anderson for the 2-year seat. How has this process been for you?
It's very intense, and it's a lot of work for everyone involved. I want to thank Carl for running a fantastic race and for raising his hand and getting involved in the community. I mean, to decide to take that step and commit yourself to public service is something that we should encourage more people to do. So I'm excited to see that, you know, we had two contested races for the school committee this year, and I think that just shows the public is interested in the future of our schools, and I think we just want to keep that momentum going.
Yeah, I think we had some great discussion at the candidates forum, both between yourself and Carl and between the other school committee seats, so that was exciting to see how many people are interested in the process, and you know, we got a lot of questions in, so I thought you both handled yourselves very well. So how was today for you? Is this, I'm sorry, I don't know, is this your first time on a ballot?
It's my very first time on the ballot.
Congratulations.
And thank you very much. And it was obviously rainy, and I want to thank there are people that stood out, held signs for all the candidates, and you know, we can't tell you how much that is appreciated by the people that are on the campaign side, by the candidates. It's for all of us, the commitment and the generosity of people in this town is, it's just, it always impresses you and surprises you. So
yeah.
So grateful. The other thing I want to make sure that I mention is all the people you don't see on TV at the school committee meetings and the people running as candidates is, you know, all of our families and friends and supporters who spend so much time helping the rest of our lives happen and spending time with the kids, spending time with family, spending time with all the other commitments we have outside of the campaign. And they are just enormously a part of this and people that we just are very grateful to and we appreciate. So thank you to all everyone who makes sacrifices so we can do what you see us do in the school committee meetings and the campaign. So,
of course,
thank you to them.
Yeah, it is local politics, so your life needs to go on beyond this as well. So, yes, of course, your supporters are very important. What are you most excited about getting into when you start your now official term, your elected term?
Well, I think we would stay with the themes that the voters were interested in, and so I'm going to be focused on working with the Board of Selectmen, the Finance Committee, and you know, other voices in our community to build sustainable and accountable schools. And you know, I think the work starts tomorrow. So we want to roll up our sleeves, and now it's time to get to work.
Great. Well, I'll just say on behalf of RCTV, congratulations again unofficially. We look forward to seeing you working in the schools and, enjoy your term.
Thank you so much, Katie. Thank you for all your work here. It's great coverage.
Thank you.
We appreciate it.
I think we're going to go over to Ryan, who has a guest over at our second set. Ryan?
I sure do. Over here on set number two at RCTV, standing with John Halsey, who is the incumbent in one of the three-year seats for the Board of Selectmen positions. John, what are your takeaways from today?
Well, other than the fact that I'll probably be cold for a week after today, it was an exciting, exhilarating day. I do have to say that the most important thing that I would like to communicate is the thanks to all those people who supported my campaign. And I must say that without question, my wife, who served as my campaign manager, certainly helped to make sure that we left everything out on the field in this particular game. Everything from, you know, signatures to sign placement to mobilizing volunteers for standouts, mobilizing volunteers. My wife, Diana, who has been my partner through everything, is the person that encouraged me and the person that took me across the line as far as the work in this campaign is concerned. And certainly beyond that, you know, we had an army of supporters, which are people who are, many of them are old friends, many of them are neighbors, and many of them are very new friends. And for that, I'm eternally grateful. It appears in an unofficial way that I'll be returned back to the job of being a selectman. I would say that what I find, Ryan, is that the election process, and I said this a little earlier today when asked, the election process, the election cycle, is the educational step. It's when you get a chance to talk to many, many voters because the issues are front and center. You answer honestly to those voters, and they honestly give you feedback on the things that are most important to them. And in my opinion, not much has changed about the idea that financial sustainability for our town, the development of budgets in both the town and the school that are both manageable and affordable, continue to be the most important thing that we face. And so the takeaway from the educational process of the election cycle is the execution process of the will of the voters, which is, as anybody that's heard me speak about this, the voters, you know, said, okay, we would like to add a new person to the mix. And so my congratulations to Andy Friedman on his very substantial win. He did a great job. His supporters mobilized and did a really good job. And if the official, unofficial results hold, and I might point out that the unofficial results have my good friend Kevin Sexton and I 5 votes apart, which is kind of a stunningly close number. And because they're unofficial, it appears that I'll be returning as a selectman, but they have to become official before that happens. And I will say this, that Kevin and I have been working partners for 3 years. The fact that we unquestionably won't be working together as selectmen won't change the fact that both of us are very actively interested and involved in the community. Both of us will continue to partner for the health and welfare of this community and its citizens. And so to Kevin, I take my hat off. However the official or unofficial results sort out, nothing will change about the fact that we have become friends and cohorts on behalf of the town of Reading. So there's been some new material that has come up during the election that we're going to need to be looking at as the new board reorganizes itself. That'll be happening sometime in the next couple of weeks, and then we move on, because the execution process, the will of the voters, is really what's the most important thing. And we've gotten so much great feedback. I'm sure Andy's got feedback that we haven't had a chance to talk about. I know I have, and I know Kevin has. So all of those things will coalesce around a new board and around a new organization as we move into town meeting. Many things on the docket in front of town meeting, including the expansion of the smart growth the district. My other takeaway from the election is one that I think highly validates a position that I strongly believed in. And that was quite simply that Reading, based on its last vote around question 4, the state question around the legalization of marijuana, was overwhelming, again, against that. We gave them the opportunity to prohibit the commercial sale, testing, and growth of marijuana in Reading, and in an overwhelming way, they accepted that opportunity to prohibit that. So that moves now on to town meeting and to the actual bylaw that will go forward. So, big day, a lot of work. Frankly, I'm glad that the election cycle is over and we can get on with the business of the town.
Well, I wish you and your supporters the best of luck of warming up from standing outside today in the cold and rain. And if the numbers do hold, again, congratulations and thanks for joining us here tonight.
Okay, thank you.
I'm going to send it back over to Katie.
Great. Thanks, Ryan. That was a great interview there with John Halsey. And we are just about ready to wrap up our coverage here of RCTV's election. We had a great time discussing with all of our candidates. We're going to run through the totals one more time. John Halsey, who we just spoke to, again, unofficially, 1,453 votes. Kevin Sexton, 1,448 votes, and Andrew Friedman, 2,071 votes. That's, again, a total for the whole town.
And we're going to look at the school committee 3-year seats here. Jean Borowski with 1,908 votes, Linda Snow-Doxer collecting 1,920 votes, and Erin Calvo-Bacci with 1,430 votes.
Ruth Doucette for the Board of Library Trustees seat got 1,199 votes. Nina Pinacchio received 1,218 votes. And Sherry Vandenacker got 1,358 votes.
For the school committee for the two-year seat, we have Carl Anderson IV with 1,049 votes and Nicholas Boivin with 1,444 votes.
For the ballot question one, the marijuana establishment ban that John Halsey just mentioned in that interview with Ryan, 2,130 yes votes, 961 no votes. So we're back and we're just about ready to wrap up. Thank you so much for watching. Thank you so much for all of the candidates for coming here today that were able to visit us and also for running on the ballot. Contested races and non-contested races. It was all great fun for us here today. And it was it's gonna be a great election and a great resounding year.
Yep. You know, thank you everyone out there for watching and sticking with RCTV through our election coverage. All the crew that we have here making sure that we can get the message out to you here on the air, and our folks down there at the Walter Hawks Fieldhouse that are bringing you live pictures from the actual polling place. So it takes a lot to bring this production to you, and we're very grateful to be able to have that opportunity.
Yes. So for on behalf of Ryan, we're going to do the numbers one more time. My apologies.
Nope.
So we are going to run those numbers one more time for you, just in case you're just tuning in now. It's just 9:30, so it's possible. These are unofficial results. They'll be certified by the town clerk forthcoming.
So looking at ballot question number one, the marijuana establishment ban, the yeses with 2,130 and the noes with 961.
The Board of Selectmen totals, John Halsey, 1,453 votes, Kevin Sexton, 1,448 votes, and Andrew Friedman, 2,071 votes.
For the school committee, the three-year seat, Gene Borowski with 1,908 votes, Linda Snow-Doxer with 1,920 votes, and Erin Calvo-Bacci with 1,430 votes.
The Board of Library Trustees, for a two-year seat, Ruth Doucette, 1,199 votes, Nina Pinacchio, 1,218 votes, Sherry Vandenacker, 1,358 votes.
And for the school committee two-year seat, Carl Anderson IV with 1,049 votes, and Nicholas Boivin with 1,444 votes.
So on behalf of Ryan, myself, and everyone here at the studio, and the folks down at the Fieldhouse who have now returned, thank you so much for watching RCTV's election coverage, and we'll see you at the next election.
Take care. Standing here over in set B with Gene Borowski, who is a candidate for the three-year seat on the school committee in the April 4th election. Gene, what are your overall assessment of the day, your takeaways?
So you can imagine, I'm just so grateful. I'm so grateful to the friends, to the neighbors, and to my family who came out and held signs in the pouring cold rain. Yeah. It was an uncomfortable day to be out for 13 hours. And to all of my neighbors who hosted lawn signs, thank you for continuing to support me. Running for re-election was hard. And I'm so very, very grateful for the support of the community. And I'm so happy, so happy that I get to continue to advocate for the students of Reading. I'm really excited about the next 3 years.
So as you look forward to the next 3 years, what are some things that are on the horizon for the school committee?
Sure. Well, I'm really proud of the campaign that I ran. And I ran with three ultimate objectives. One was we need to make sure that there is equity in student outcomes across our district. So that's getting every school to a level two. The other is dealing with our funding challenges. We most certainly have funding challenges in Reading. And the third is continuing to advocate for better communication across the district. So I think there's a lot of good that's happening in Reading, and I'm excited to get to be part of continuing that improvement.
So obviously when you look back at the election cycle, there's a lot that goes into it. And as you mentioned before, the people that were involved in it and the people outside today that were holding signs in the rain, and I'm sure warming up at this point now as we're later on into the evening. But what is it, when you reflect on the experience, what does that mean to you?
Two things. One is I have a sister, Mary, who, and my mom, I'm going to thank both of them, and my mother-in-law also. My mother-in-law is a Reading resident, so she's kind of wears dual hats, but my mom and my sister don't live in Reading, and they came out to hold signs. And they actually said two things they noticed. One is, wow, there's a lot of civic engagement in Reading. And I said, yeah, there really is, and how awesome is that? And the other thing they noted, and it bears mentioning, is the, you know, today was election day, and every candidate was walking up and down that line saying, do you need hand warmers? Would you like a cup of coffee? You can use my table. You can use my tent. There was this wonderful spirit of camaraderie, and I just really am optimistic and quite confident that that's what's going to carry us forward into the next, you know, tomorrow we're going to wake up, and we're all going to come together, and we're all going to make sure that Reading is an amazing place to live with an amazing school district moving forward. So I'm very excited about that.
Perfect. Well, congratulations on a successfully run campaign, and we look forward to seeing what the next 3 years have in store.
Thank you so much, Ryan.
All right. And that will do it with our interview with Gene.
Thank you.